James chapter 1, in verse 16, okay? It says, "Don't be deceived, my dear brothers. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all he created. My dear brothers, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. For a man's anger does not bring about the righteous life that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you." Stop there, and let's pray. Jesus, fill us with wisdom and understanding from your word. We're looking to you today to fill our hearts. We ask it in that powerful name given above every name, the name of Jesus. Amen. James is a man who writes and likes to talk about contrasts because they help us to understand things. We like contrasts, by the way. I like to watch HGTV from time to time because it's fun to watch those before and after sorts of things of houses, you know. I love to watch, what's that one about get it ready to sell, buy it, sell it now, whatever thingy, I can't remember. Anyway, it's a great show on there because they go in to these homes and they do these little mini makeovers or whatever and get it ready to sell. And it's great seeing the before pictures and the after pictures. I love seeing them side by side. And they show the before and then the after, you go, whoa, it's just so cool. And we even like contrast when it comes to people. Before she lost 100 pounds, now after she's been on the diet or something, you know. And I saw an ad. I was joking with Sue the other day, and it said on this thing online, it said, "Minnesota woman loses 100 pounds using one simple rule." And I turned to Sue and I said, "Yeah, don't eat. Stop eating. You're bound to lose weight. Might not live to tell about it, but you'll lose weight." Anyway, you've seen those pictures, haven't you? You know, I went from a size 16 to a size 1. And we look at it and we all go, ooh. And then we see that little type at the bottom of the page, you know? And they say, "Results not typical." But that's okay. We like to see the contrast anyway, you know? That's what James is doing here in this epistle. He's giving us contrasts to look at so we can talk about the before and the after. And you'll remember in the previous verses, he has given us a pretty dark backdrop with which to look at the verses we're going to look at today. And the backdrop that was given to us before was how sin and death takes hold in the life of an individual. And you'll remember that James said that it all begins with temptation, that then merges with desire, that then gives birth to sin, when full grown gives birth to death. And he talked about that progression that goes from temptation to death with those various stages in between. That is the dark side of what we're looking at, that we'll begin to see a bit of a contrast here in these verses. And he begins here in verse 16 by saying, you know, my brothers, my dear brothers, in fact, he says, don't be deceived. Don't be deceived. Is it possible for a Christian to be deceived? Absolutely, it's possible. But he says, don't be deceived. Why? Because he says that every good, now we're talking about good. We were talking about bad before. Now it's good. Every good and perfect gift is from above. And so after making the point not to be deceived, he adds and says that whereby before we were talking about the byproduct of temptation and desire and sin and death, now we're talking about the byproduct of that work of grace in our lives that whereby God gives us good and perfect things. And so he tells us here that there are stages leading to sin, there are blessings that come from God, and don't be deceived about what is good and what is bad. Because every good gift and every perfect gift comes from God. It's kind of, you know, whenever I'm talking to a brand new believer, Somebody who's just recently given their heart to the Lord, I know that there's coming in their lives some kind of a crash, you know? Because it's so good at first. You know, when they first realize their need of a Savior, they first recognize that Jesus is that Savior, and they embrace Him as Savior. They accept Him into their hearts. There's such a sense of God's love, and there's such a sense of God's completeness, and they're just delighted with all of that, you know. And it's kind of like they're going, you know, oh, Lord, You're so good, and it's so wonderful. And then they open their eyes, and they realize they're in the same world they were before. And that same world is absolutely, you know, racked with sin and depravity and darkness and the struggles of life. And they're kind of like, God, I accepted You. I opened my heart to You. I've received Your love and Your grace. But why hasn't anything changed outside here? And it's possible to start confusing the difficulties and the challenges that we struggle with here in life as that which comes from God. And James says, don't confuse the two. Don't confuse the two. Every good and perfect gift comes from above. But we still live in a sin-soaked world. We still live in a fallen earth. And that fallenness is going to touch you. And it may even touch you in a significant way. But don't be deceived. Don't be led astray. I remember when I was a fairly new believer from the standpoint of really walking with God consistently, I remember sitting down with my pastor one time when life was getting kind of nasty, and I said to him, I said these very words. I said, if this is what it's like to be a Christian, I'm not sure I want to be one. And he just kind of laughed at me. But I was serious. I was confusing the grace, love, the tenderness of God with the fact that even though I am saved, I'm still living in a pretty rotten world that doles out some pretty rotten stuff from time to time. And not to confuse the two. James says, don't be deceived. Don't confuse the two. Every good and perfect gift comes from God. And notice how he describes God at the end of verse 17. You look there with me. He says that he is the Father. He calls him the Father of the heavenly lights who does not change like shifting shadows. And of course, this description of God stands in stark contrast to the character and the effects of sin. Remember, that's what James likes to do. He likes to contrast things. And he's basically saying, whereas sin casts a person into spiritual darkness and the constancy of change and difficulty, there is something in your life that never changes, and that's God. In fact, there's one thing in your life that never changes, and that's God. And so he talks about the God who gives us every good and perfect gift, who does not change like shifting shadows. By the way, this is where that phrase comes from in the great old hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. There is no shadow of turning in Thee. It comes right from this very verse. If you read it in the King James Bible, it's very much like that. But you know, I think about this life that we live in, and it's constantly changing, much to our chagrin. You know, I want things to sometimes stay the same when they're good. And I was thinking about the fact that, you know, my oldest daughter and her husband and their two kids are now living, of all places, in South Dakota while he goes to school. And although I appreciate those little fun video chats we get to do with the kids on the computer, I still can't, you know, sweep them up into my arms and give them a kiss on the cheek and tickle them. And sometimes I think to myself, why did it have to change? Why do things have to change? Why do they have to be different? You know what? That's the world we live in. It's constantly changing. It's constantly moving. The earth is constantly rotating. It's, you know, we're just everything changes. One thing doesn't change. God never changes. And that's such wonderful news for us to be able to lay hold of. And James wants us to lay hold of it, to understand that there is something of stability that you can have in your life, that I can have in my life, and it's God. There's nothing in the world. If you're going to look for stability out there, forget it. And you can even look for that stability in some of the most wonderful things that this life has to offer, like the ability to marry and have children and all the wonderful things that go along with having a home and the blessings of friends and so forth. But it changes. People get older. There's not one of us in this room who isn't a day older than we were yesterday. and who isn't subject to the passage of time with all of its ravages and changes. I'm not trying to, you know, bum you out here today. I'm simply trying to underscore what James is helping us to see by contrast, and that is that God is unchanging. There is no changing, no shadow of turning, if you will. And then James is going to make another contrast here as we look at verse 18 again. Remember how he talked about he used human birthing terms to describe sin and the darkness and the death that comes from that. Now look at verse 18. Now we have the contrast. And it says, he chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all he created. So he talked about what sin does in our life earlier, and now he talks about what God does in our life through his word. And James reminds us that God chose us to give us birth unto life through his word. And that basically just underscores that whole concept of the fact that you and I are born again. So, we're children of God, right? Isn't that wonderful? But you know what's crazy about that? The Bible says that we're a new creation, right? Isn't that what it says? The Bible says everybody who comes to Christ, they're a new creation. The old's gone, the new has come. Well, once again, you got to kind of hold the hand of that new believer because they're walking through life going, okay, new creation, new has come, old is gone, and they open their eyes and it's still, again, the same raunchy world that they were in when they accepted Christ. Here's the paradox of what really goes on. You are in Christ a new creation, but you're living in the middle of an old one that's breaking down and deteriorating day by day. But you're a new creation. I mean, that's the truth of that statement is just as secure and just as stable as it ever has been. I am a new creation in Christ, and every single day God is forming me in a greater way into the image of my Savior, Jesus Christ. Wonderful, wonderful truth. But all out here, spinning around you and I, is this world that's absolutely heading down that, you know, porcelain chute that we like to call the toilet. It's that's what's happening. And you can't sugarcoat it and make it sound any better. It's just life. If you and I are looking out here for our hope, if we're looking out here for newness and change that is godly and pure, you're going to be disappointed. The Jews who confronted Jesus with their thoughts about the kingdom of God were disappointed with what Jesus told them. Because you see, the Jews were expecting a physical manifestation of the kingdom of God. In other words, they believed that when the Messiah came, he would put down the enemies of Israel. And of course, at that time, it was Rome who had come in, conquered the Jews, and taken up residence in their country. And the Jews wanted them gone. We don't want them here. We don't want them telling us what to do. We don't want to pay their taxes. And so they kept talking to him about, when's the kingdom of God going to come? And Jesus kept saying things that absolutely made them frustrated. He'd say, the kingdom of God is upon you. And they'd go, what? When? Show me. And here's what Jesus would come back and say. The kingdom of God is within you. What? Yeah, the kingdom of God. He said, don't go looking for the kingdom of God to advance like the kingdoms of men. The kingdom of God begins in here. When you and I bow the knee, accept Christ as our Savior, the kingdom of God begins here. And he says, the kingdom of God does not come in the way that a man can perceive with his human eyes. But it is there nonetheless. When you and I accept Christ as Savior, a throne is established in our heart for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And Jesus Christ becomes seated on that throne. And we begin to learn about the Lordship of Jesus Christ. His kingdom truly is begun inside of our hearts. And it's a wonderful, glorious thing. But you can't tell it by looking in a mirror. And maybe that person, that friend or relative who saw you before you accepted Jesus, I mean the day before, and then they see you again the day after, they're not going to look at you and go, something's different. Combing your hair different there, partner? You get new dentures? No, it's not going to be visible to the naked eye. It's not going to be visible from a human perspective. But the kingdom of God has begun. Now, they might be able to see a sense of joy, but that's a byproduct. That's just a byproduct. The kingdom of God is within. Don't go looking out here. Don't go looking for your satisfaction, your hope, your joy out there. It ain't going to happen. Out there is still the same fallen, sin-soaked world it ever has been. Now, there's coming a day when God promises us in His Word He's going to make it all new. But that isn't yet. And for right now, we live by faith, don't we? That's a hard way to live. It's a difficult way to live by faith. I look with the eyes of faith and I see that which is coming. And I can even embrace it and rejoice in it as if it's already here. But by the same token, I realize I'm living in a world that's full of sin. So he goes on now in verse 19. Look with me there. And he says, my dear brothers, and again, he's talking to believers here. He says, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. For man's anger does not bring about the righteous life that God desires. I read these two verses and I think to myself, what kind of a world would we be in if we all obeyed these verses to the letter? You know, you ever stop to think about that? If we absolutely followed the guidelines of this verse, we were quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry. There's a verse in the Proverbs, which we just finished up, by the way, on Wednesday night. We'll move on to the book of Ecclesiastes when we pick up our Wednesday night services in September. But anyway, there's a verse in there that says this. It says, he who answers before listening, that is folly. In other words, that's foolishness and is to his shame. And I confess to the people who come on Wednesday night when we went through that verse, I've done that. I've spoken up before the person was even done talking. And I gave my opinion before I should have been done listening to what they had to say. And I say that again to my own shame. But isn't it interesting, even from creation, that God reveals some of this to us by giving us two ears and one mouth? As if to say, you know, you ought to be occupied probably listening about twice as much as you do talking. Because when we talk, we get into trouble. And often when we talk, we get into arguments. And when we get into arguments, we become angry. And when we become angry, the sinful nature is right there to mess things up. And you know, they talk about righteous anger. I've said to you many times before, you know, I'm 51 years old. I know I don't look a day over 52. But at 51, I cannot tell you that I have ever felt righteous anger in my life. I am so aware of my sinful nature and how it just really pollutes everything. I don't know, maybe I started off being righteously angry for a nanosecond. And then it went into some kind of a sinful response. It's so difficult for you and I to be angry about anything and to do it righteously. And James says to us here, man's anger does not bring about the righteous life that God desires. It just doesn't work. Anger doesn't help. I wish that I could be like Jesus and get angry and not sin. But I don't think I've ever done that. And you know, I think it's even a good word for parents. You know, there was a point in time where I realized I didn't have to get angry with my kids. Doesn't mean that I don't get angry from time to time. I try not to, and praise God, you know, I've got a fairly long fuse, but it wasn't always the case. And I remember though a time in my life when it kind of like a bell rung in my head, and it was like, I don't have to yell at these guys. And if I do feel like I have to yell, it's probably because I've trained them that I have to yell. You know how that is? You know how kids do that? Kids know by the decibel level in your voice whether or not you mean it. Right? Because we train them that way. We say to them, all right, kids, it's time to go. And they go, yeah, okay, he doesn't mean it. And then a few minutes later, it's up slightly. Kids, I told you it's time to go. And the kids go, yeah, he still doesn't mean it. He's trained us. He told us this in the past, time and time again. And then finally, after a couple more times, eventually the decibel level reaches that level. Kids, I said it's time to go. And the kids go, he means it now. And they go. And then we ask the dumbest question in the world. Why is it I have to yell at you guys? And if the kids were really able to tell the truth, they'd say, because that's the way you trained us. Now, if they did, that would be a little smart alecky. And we wouldn't appreciate that, especially when we're angry. But it's true. I finally realized if I have to repeat something with my kids and raise the decibel level of my voice to the point of anger, it's because I've trained my kids not to do what I asked them to do until I reached that decibel level. It's like, Paul, you're an idiot. Let's talk to the kids, sit down and say, all right, here's what we're going to do. When I tell you to do something the first time, you do it. Okay? And, sometimes it takes some positive reinforcement to make that happen. But the fact of the matter is, it is so cool to not to realize I don't have to get angry in order to do things. And when I do, it's not going to be good. Man's anger does not bring about the righteous life that God desires. Verse 21, therefore. Remember that word, therefore. Whenever you see it, you always stop and say, what is it there for? And what it's there for is to tie in what we've just said to what the point that's going to be made now. Therefore, let's get rid of all moral filth and evil. Your Bible may use the words overflow of wickedness, which I kind of like. I think that's really descriptive. Overflow of wickedness. Isn't that a great term? Isn't that just what you want to say after you get done watching the news in the evening? What was on the news tonight, honey? It was just an overflow of wickedness. It's very, very good. I mean, it's appropriate as far as a title. He says, that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Well, moral filth and evil, of course, are very prevalent in our society. So what does James tell us to do with it? He says, all right, put up with moral filth. He doesn't say that, does he? He doesn't say, ignore moral filth. Turn the other way. Just turn the other way, kids. Just don't look at it. Just don't look. Nor does he, of course, say, embrace moral filth. What he says is, get rid of it. And notice how much moral filth we're supposed to get rid of. All moral filth. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth. It's kind of like taking out the garbage. You know, in my own personal Bible reading time, I've just finished going through Kings and Chronicles. 1st, 2nd Kings, 1st, 2nd Chronicles. I love reading through those books, even though there's a redundancy that you begin to pick up on over a period of time, where the nation of Israel rises and falls and rises and falls into depravity and rises to some kind of a bit of excitement about the Lord and then falls back again. But I like to read about the kings who came into power during those times of revival, because it seems like such a fun time in which to live. Because what they would do was they would go into the temple and they would go around the land and they'd pick up everything that was kind of part and parcel of the idolatry that Israel had been engaging in, and they'd break it down, and they'd go into the temple and they'd say, get rid of, cut down that vile Asherah pole and take out the temple of Baal, and we're going to take them. And Josiah was one of the greatest kings. He would took all this stuff to the Kidron Valley and they burned it. You know, isn't that fun just to burn things? Just get them in there and burn them. And they would go through the land in the high places and they'd cut down this and grab this and the thing, the altar, and then burn them. And it must have just been fun. Wouldn't that be a fun time to live in? Well, but that's exactly what James is telling you and I to do. It's exactly what he's encouraging you and I to do. You got any altars in your life that are like erected to other gods? Gods of pleasure, gods of money, gods of this, gods of that. He says, get in here and break them down. Haul them off to the Kidron Valley and set them on fire. Cool. You know? It's not very easy, though, is it? It's not very easy to clean house. And frankly, we can't just stop at cleaning house. Did you notice he didn't just say, rid your lives of all that moral filth and then we'll all be good and holy and we'll levitate off the ground about 6 inches and we'll all be really... He didn't stop there. He says, rid your life of all those things. And then he goes on at the end of it and says, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. You see, you can't go around your life always saying no. I mean, no is a good thing to say, but you can't stop there. You can't look at everything that's evil and rotten and stuff and say no. Some parents do this with their kids, and it really frustrates them. Dad, can we go to the movie? No. Can we go to the park? No. Dad, what can we do? No. And they never get around to saying yes to anything or providing any kind of, you know, pure and godly sort of enjoyment or entertainment. You remember, when Jesus told about the man who had a demon? He was invested with a demonic presence, and the Bible says that the demon, you know, was cast out of the man. But eventually the demon came back to the same host, and he realized that although the man was now swept and put in order from the standpoint of demon activity, there was nothing in it. He was empty. And so it says he went back and got seven more demons more powerful than himself, and they all invested the man and they took up residence there. And Jesus said to us that that man's condition now was worse than before. Why? He got swept clean, but there was nothing to replace it. You see? And so the whole idea of saying no is good, but you can't stop there. You got to say yes. And what James tells you and I to say yes to is the Word of God. Allowing the Word of God in our lives to fashion how we live, fashion the things that we do. I know that sounds like some kind of radical weirdness, but it's not. It's using the Word of God as a guideline in our lives to know, this is how I'm going to live. These are the kind of things I'm going to do. These are the things that I'm going to be involved in. And I'm not going to live like this just because my neighbor lives like that. I'm going to live the way the Lord wants me to live. So I'm going to humbly accept the Word of God. And why does he use that word humbly? Because the opposite of humble is prideful. And when I'm prideful, I don't want anybody telling me anything about what to do or how to live my life. Get out of my face, leave me alone, and just... You know? But you know what that is? It's pride. It's pride. But when I'm humble, I'm teachable. And I approach the Word of God basically by saying, okay, God, teach me today. I open my heart to you and what you want to say, how you want to instruct me. And I want to pattern my life after the wisdom and the guidance that's in this word. And I know that I live in this world that's pretty fallen and pretty rotten. But I realize too that that's not the way you want me to live. You want me to get rid of all moral filth and the overflow of wickedness. And you want me to live according to the pattern laid down in your word through the power and strength of the Holy Spirit. So open my heart and teach me today. That takes humility. Humility. And God will probably bring you to a place of humility one way or another. And if it has to come through brokenness, so be it. But it will come. And it was like, I don't have to yell at these guys. And if I do feel like I have to yell, it's probably because I've trained them that I have to yell. You know how that is? You know how kids do that? Kids know by the decibel level in your voice whether or not you mean it. Right? Because we train them that way. We say to them, all right, kids, it's time to go. And they go, yeah, okay, he doesn't mean it. And then a few minutes later, it's up slightly. Kids, I told you it's time to go. And the kids go, yeah, he still doesn't mean it. He's trained us. He told us this in the past, time and time again. And then finally, after a couple more times, eventually the decibel level reaches that level. Kids, I said it's time to go. And the kids go, he means it now. And they go. And then we ask the dumbest question in the world. Why is it I have to yell at you guys? And if the kids were really able to tell the truth, they'd say, because that's the way you trained us. Now, if they did, that would be a little smart alecky. And we wouldn't appreciate that, especially when we're angry. But it's true. I finally realized if I have to repeat something with my kids and raise the decibel level of my voice to the point of anger, it's because I've trained my kids not to do what I asked them to do until I reached that decibel level. It's like, Paul, you're an idiot. Let's talk to the kids, sit down and say, all right, here's what we're going to do. When I tell you to do something the first time, you do it. Okay? And, you know, sometimes it takes some positive reinforcement to make that happen. But the fact of the matter is, it is so cool to not to realize I don't have to get angry in order to do things. And when I do, it's not going to be good. Man's anger does not bring about the righteous life that God desires. Verse 21, therefore. Remember that word, therefore. Whenever you see it, you always stop and say, what is it there for? And what it's there for is to tie in what we've just said to what the point that's going to be made now. Therefore, let's get rid of all moral filth and evil. Your Bible may use the words overflow of wickedness, which I kind of like. I think that's really descriptive. Overflow of wickedness. Isn't that a great term? Isn't that just what you want to say after you've been watching the news in the evening? What was on the news tonight, honey? It was just an overflow of wickedness. It's very, very good. I mean, it's appropriate as far as a title. He says, that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Well, moral filth and evil, of course, are very prevalent in our society. So what does James tell us to do with it? He says, all right, put up with moral filth. He doesn't say that, does he? He doesn't say, ignore moral filth. Turn the other way. Just turn the other way, kids. Just don't look at it. Just don't look. Nor does he, of course, say, embrace moral filth. What he says is, get rid of it. And notice how much moral filth we're supposed to get rid of. All moral filth. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth. It's kind of like taking out the garbage. You know, in my own personal Bible reading time, I've just finished going through Kings and Chronicles. 1st, 2nd Kings, 1st, 2nd Chronicles. I love reading through those books, even though there's a redundancy that you begin to pick up on over a period of time, where the nation of Israel rises and falls and rises and falls into depravity and rises to some kind of a, you know, bit of a excitement about the Lord and then falls back again. But I like to read about the kings who came into power during those times of revival, because it seems like such a fun time in which to live. Because what they would do was they would go into the temple and they would go around the land and they'd pick up everything that was kind of part and parcel of the idolatry that Israel had been engaging in, and they'd break it down, and they'd go into the temple and they'd say, get rid of, cut down that vile Asherah pole and take out the temple of Baal, and we're going to take them. And Josiah was one of the greatest kings. He would took all this stuff to the Kidron Valley and they burned it. You know, isn't that fun just to burn things? Just get them in there and burn them. And they would go through the land in the high places and they'd cut down this and grab this and the thing, the altar, and then burn them. And it must have just been fun. Wouldn't that be a fun time to live in? Well, but that's exactly what James is telling you and I to do. It's exactly what he's encouraging you and I to do. You got any altars in your life that are like erected to other gods? Gods of pleasure, gods of money, gods of this, gods of that. He says, get in here and break them down. Haul them off to the Kidron Valley and set them on fire. Cool. You know? It's not very easy, though, is it? It's not very easy to clean house. And frankly, we can't just stop at cleaning house. Did you notice he didn't just say, rid your lives of all that moral filth and then we'll all be good and holy and we'll levitate off the ground about 6 inches and we'll all be really... He didn't stop there. He said, he says, rid your life of all those things. And then he goes on at the end of it and says, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. You see, you can't go around your life always saying no. I mean, no is a good thing to say, but you can't stop there. You can't look at everything that's evil and rotten and stuff and say no. Some parents do this with their kids, and it really frustrates them. Dad, can we go to the movie? No. Can we go to the park? No. Dad, what can we do? No. And they never get around to saying yes to anything or providing any kind of, you know, pure and godly sort of enjoyment or entertainment. You remember? Remember when Jesus told about the man who had a demon? He was invested with a demonic presence, and the Bible says that the demon, you know, was cast out of the man. But eventually the demon came back to the same host, and he realized that although the man was now swept and put in order from the standpoint of demon activity, there was nothing in it. He was empty. And so it says he went back and got seven more demons more powerful than himself, and they all invested the man and they took up residence there. And Jesus said to us that that man's condition now was worse than before. Why? He got swept clean, but there was nothing to replace it. You see? And so the whole idea of saying no is good, but you can't stop there. You got to say yes. And what James tells you and I to say yes to is the Word of God. Allowing the Word of God in our lives to fashion how we live, fashion the things that we do. I know that sounds like some kind of radical weirdness, but it's not. It's using the Word of God as a guideline in our lives to know, this is how I'm going to live. These are the kind of things I'm going to do. These are the things that I'm going to be involved in. And I'm not going to live like this just because my neighbor lives like that. I'm going to live the way the Lord wants me to live. So I'm going to humbly accept the Word of God. And why does he use that word humbly? Because the opposite of humble is prideful. And when I'm prideful, I don't want anybody telling me anything about what to do or how to live my life. Get out of my face, leave me alone, and just... You know? But you know what that is? It's pride. It's pride. But when I'm humble, I'm teachable. And I approach the Word of God basically by saying, okay, God, teach me today. I open my heart to you and what you want to say, how you want to instruct me. And I want to pattern my life after the wisdom and the guidance that's in this word. And I know that I live in this world that's pretty fallen and pretty rotten. But I realize too that that's not the way you want me to live. You want me to get rid of all moral filth and the overflow of wickedness. And you want me to live according to the pattern laid down in your word through the power and strength of the Holy Spirit. So open my heart and teach me today. That takes humility. Humility. And God will probably bring you to a place of humility one way or another. And if it has to come through brokenness, so be it. But it will come.